a manly and a strong mucolite intelligence. Now, obviously, these what people call K9 and K4 mathematician parts serve as basis for most of heteroformatum and euchromatum research in these marks in fact. But the key question for us in those days is how exactly you created such a defined pattern as this one. Now one thing which we knew is there are boundary elements or exudators which surround these two, which don't let this heterochromatin go into the basis. But how do you really target heterochromatin in this case? Now for that matter, the work actually which we initiated many years ago when I was fellow in Amar Khan's lab, we had found that this SENET element, which resembles centrohelix, if you delete this element, it leads to loss of heterochromatin across this. So we knew this repeat element was important. Now subsequently, however, we found that these repeat elements can actually be transcribed, but their RNAs are processed into small RNA by RNAi. Not only this element, but its related elements, what we call DGDH repeats at centromeres, are transcribed. And if you do small RNA plot in wild type cells, you would see small RNA produced from these repeat elements that disappear if you delete components of the RNAi machinery, such as carbonyl protein and the disulfide. We also knew that if you target this repeat element to an ectopic site in the genome, for example, if you fuse it to this AD6 gene somewhere else in the genome, this element is sufficient to cause formation of that is measured using a chip assay with either SWI6, which is an HP1 homolog in fission yeast, or using methyl K9 antibody. You could see the histone HP lysine methylation is enriched at this particular site in wild type cells, but not in these RNAi cells. So this element targets the neurochromatin in a manner dependent on RNAi. Since then, we have actually come along with the work from a number of different labs, including our own, has led to the following model. What we know now is repeats actually are transcribed by RNA polymerase. But their RNAs are processed into small RNAs by various complexes, for example, this carbonyl-containing Ritz complex, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase complex, and enzyme dicer processed small RNA. Transcription of these repeats occurs preferentially during S-phase part of the cell. And the loading of actually this argonaut complex which binds to this intransient and this class of methyl transferase, which actually methylates lysine I, occurs in equivalent repeat. Now these two complexes are physically associated with each other. If you purify component of this methyl transferase complex, you are keeping components of this Ritz complex along with it. So these complexes actually localize in an incorporative manner. But once methyl transferase is localized, it methylates lysine 9 of histone HT, creating binding sites for chromodomain protein, including a component of the Ritz RNAi complex of CHIP1. Now, the binding of this protein to methyl mark effectively establishes what we call a self-reinforcing loop that allows RNAi to act in cis to efficiently process transcripts into small RNAs. Now obviously this sort of loops are important not only for processing but also for inheritance and maintenance of heterochromatic structures. But the importance of this loop is pointed out by this one result where if you delete a chromatin modifying factor which methylates lysine 9, you actually lose small RNAs in the same way as you see loss of small RNAs upon argonaut mutation. So, the improvement of this machinery here with the help of this carbon foundry is really how to efficiently process these transcripts in 4 hours. Now, endochromatin not only causes post-transcriptional silencing, it actually also causes transcriptional silencing. For that matter, there are two other chromatin proteins, which we call HP1 proteins, CYP2 and SPY3. The names are not important. What is important is that these proteins actually help in recruitment of enzymatic activities such as SHRAC and CLAS6. Now these complexes are purified by Tomosomiyama and his Niclosin lab, actually are exposed to DSPAs activity. Remember, I mentioned earlier the de-escalation of histone is really a conserved property of endochromatin different species. Now HP1 proteins recruit these histone de-escalases, which then cause silencing by mediating proper positioning of nucleosomes. Now, why do we believe that? Yet we know, indeed, that HP1 mediated recruitment of SHRAC, as well as a complex containing CLAS6 and its associated chaperone activities, is important for de-escalation of histones, as well as positioning of nucleosomes at heterochromatin regions. SHRAC also contains a SNF2 family chromatin rewilding factor. Now, if you mutate the catalytic site of this histone de-escalase or this ATPase domain of this SNF2 rewilding enzyme, what you see is the nucleosomes start shifting in heterochromatic regions. Now, that is demonstrated using this microfocal nucleus digestion assay, where in wild-type cells, you see that the nucleosomes at a heterochromatin domain are nicely positioned, but if you mutate the catalytic sites of these two enzymes, you see shifting of nucleosomes and new hypersensitive sites appearing, leading to formation of nucleosomes. That allows RNA-42 machinery to access these repeat regions and transcribe them, leading to loss of heterochromatic transcriptional silence. Now, a key question which I'm asked often is that these enzymes actually also are targeting other parts of the DNA. Why are these enzymes so heavily recruited to heterochromatic regions? Now, for that, I like to argue, this is an argument based on some of the work which John Widom and colleagues have done. What they have done is, they have made argument that the genomes actually have a nucleosome positioning code that play an important role in the positioning nucleosomes. And I like to argue that heterochromatin, which largely assemble on transposons in the piece, or the foreign DNA,
テレビ東京。